Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Kraken Calling, a novel by Aric McBay. Narrated by Eleanor Caudill. We are what we pretend to be, so we must be very careful what we pretend to be. Kurt Vonnegut. Belief initiates and guides action, or it does nothing. Octavia E. Butler, Parable of the Sower. Chapter 1. 2051. Evelyn was summoned by her supervisor just as the overhead lights dimmed for midday power down. She quickly finished collating the sheaf of paper in front of her. The pages felt slightly damp, as always in winter, but fingerless gloves kept sensation in her digits. She knocked on her boss's door with one hand, tucking the other into her pocket to warm it. Her breath hung visibly in the air for the moment before he called her in. His corner office was warmer than the secretarial pool where she worked. He faced a window, suede gloved hands behind his back, observing the city street below.
"It's a beautiful morning, isn't it, Miss Park?" he asked, without turning to look at her.
A haze of charcoal smoke hung in the air, shot through with shafts of sunlight from a mostly overcast sky. A four-story brick building down the street, once a library, was being demolished by a large crew of workers, all red tags, no doubt, with picks and sledgehammers. Dust from their labor mingled with the airborne smoke. Loose piles of brick and lumber radiated from the worksite across an empty street, an explosion in slow motion. Evelyn could see workers swinging hammers, the sound of each strike delayed by distance and muted by the office's thick window glass.
"Very pretty," she answered.
Her boss went over to a small pot-bellied stove in the corner. Atop it, a pot of coffee percolated the same grounds it had been boiling all week. Evelyn's boss put a few scoops of charcoal into the stove. Evelyn knew immediately something was wrong. She had never seen him dirty his hands filling the stove himself. He would always ask someone else to do the job, all the while muttering about rations and bandits and the shortage of charcoal from the north. Not today. He sat down at his desk and spoke without making eye contact.
"I'm sorry, Miss Park. We can't give you the promotion you asked for."
Evelyn kept her face blank, but her disappointment was deep. At home, Sarah and Sid had eaten the last of their apples, and winter was still in its early days.
"I have people to take care of," she said. "Rations have been smaller."
He nodded, lips tight, eyes averted.
"We don't have the budget for it. Healthcare Records Administration just isn't profitable. We need to cut costs, in point of fact."
He fiddled with the lapel of his old but tasteful suit, adjusting the green plastic card that peeked from his breast pocket.
"I've just laid two people off."
Evelyn bit her lip. "I'm fast. I do my job well. I catch other people's mistakes. I'm worth a raise." He sighed.
"The problem isn't just here. We're at the bottom of the heap. But it's like this all across the public sector, except triage administration, of course."
"So send me there," she said, surprising herself. She knew almost nothing about triage administration, except that it was famously tight-lipped, that compensation was generous, and that they were short-staffed after a spate of cyber attacks. He made eye contact with her for the first time, eyebrows raised.
"I can't give up one of my star employees."
She weighed her words. "If I'm one of your star employees, think of what they would give you in exchange." He stared at her, mouth half open, in silent cogitation. Then he smiled, picked up his phone, and, as she sat across the desk from him, effusively praised her to some triage administration bureaucrat before explaining how much of a budget boost he would need to be willing to part with her. When he hung up, he looked deeply satisfied with himself.
"Great demand at triage administration these days. Very busy. Excellent revenues."
He stood abruptly.
"You start today. They're waiting for you. Good luck."
She stood, thanked him politely, and shook his gloved hand.
"Go by human resources for your paycheck before you leave," he added.
There was a line in the human resources office. Evelyn wasn't the only one leaving,
but at least she wasn't being laid off. As she queued up, the person at the front of the line argued with an HR staffer.
"This isn't the right amount," said a woman in her 40s who appeared flushed and sweating despite the chilly air. "I worked 2.5 days this period. You're barely paying me anything."
YEA service charges are weekly, explained the staffer in a calm, nasal voice. You get charged flat fees every week for basic services, same as everybody else. Vaccine surcharge, infrastructure upkeep, security patrol, epidemiology service, triage administration.
It's not fair to charge me all at once and use my whole paycheck, the woman protested.
You can come back tomorrow to work out a payment plan, he said.
I can't get in here tomorrow. My pass is only good if I work in this zone.
Then wait until I've dealt with this line, replied the staffer.
Next.
When Evelyn was called up, the HR staffer swiped her debit card, depositing her minuscule paycheck, and inspected her triage tag.
Triage administration is green zone, so I'll need to flash your card.
Evelyn handed over her yellow tag, a thick plastic card that displayed her photo and a barcode. The staffer inspected the scuffed and worn card skeptically. He opened a safe, put Evelyn's old yellow tag inside, and retrieved a shiny new white one.
Do you live in the green zone? The staffer asked.
Yellow too, Evelyn replied.
Once you're at triage administration, you should move, the staffer advised. There's a freshly renewed neighborhood nearby. Green zone's much nicer once you can afford it, he added,
touching the new white card to a panel on the desk. There was a beep, and the card turned green.
Have your travel papers updated at triage administration today, or you'll have trouble at the checkpoint tomorrow morning, he said as he passed her the green tag.
Evelyn inspected the new tag. As she watched, her face, name, and barcode appeared on the front. She clipped the tag onto her shirt. Evelyn bade goodbye to her coworkers, made perfunctory promises to stay in touch. From a hook, she collected her coat, a dark jacket her partner Sarah had made for her. She retrieved her lunch from the cold room, literally an office with no heating that they used as a refrigerator, then walked down 3 flights of stairs and out the front door. The air outside was cool and damp and smelled faintly of acrid smoke. On the street, she heard the sounds of the red tag demolition crew, the ring of steel on steel, and the dull clunk of hammer on brick. She walked in the opposite direction, toward the triage administration building a few kilometers away. The street was mostly empty this time of day. Adjacent buildings had been sealed off for quarantine. She saw a handful of other pedestrians and a few couriers on bicycles. From a parallel street, she heard the rumble of automobiles and big trucks, but none was in sight. Evelyn passed a cluster of armband-wearing public safety officers as they emerged from a quarantine building. They were low-level contractors, yellow tags with a ragged look. Their uniforms were not uniform at all, but patched together ensembles combining police garb, military fatigues, and black leather jackets scrounged from any number of picked-over military supply depots, thrift stores, and garbage piles. Some wore mismatched knee pads and oversized boots. They were armed variously with police batons, metal pipes, and Bowie knives, strapped visibly to their hips. One had a handgun in his belt, though it was hard to imagine that a rough-looking street-level contractor possessed more than a handful of ammunition. They stared at Evelyn as she went by. She didn't make eye contact. Evelyn soon turned onto a larger avenue, passing through the wide gate in a recently built brick barricade, topped with razor wire. The brick was the same color as that of the demolished library. The city was filled with such walls now, though this new gate was unguarded as she passed through it. A few tattered propaganda posters had been affixed to the wall by the emergency authority. They bore mottos like, "Watch for signs of infection," "Prosperity restored," and "Say yes to YEA." Evelyn shook her head. Even she could have come up with better slogans. On the avenue, there was more foot traffic, single pedestrians like herself, green tag business people walking in pairs, and 2 crews of red-tagged laborers on their way to a job site. Evelyn heard a clang some distance behind her. She glanced over her shoulder to see that the gate she had passed through moments before was now closed and locked. On the far side was one of the ragged guards she had passed. She shook off a skin-crawling sensation and picked up her stride. She started to wonder if she should have chosen a different route. Before 60 seconds had passed, an old school bus painted dull green pulled across the road 100 meters in front of her. Several public safety officers exited the front doors. One of them retrieved a coil of razor wire from the side of the bus and began to unspool it across the road. A surprise checkpoint. Evelyn's pulse quickened. Her documentation was in order, but she hated checkpoints. She gave a cursory glance up and down the street. The alleyways and side streets had been permanently blocked off, and anyone who lived on the avenue would have locked their doors upon seeing the arrival of the bus. Evelyn saw public safety officers manning the checkpoint, all wearing blue latex gloves and white medical face masks. The first officer wore the crisp black uniform of armor security and questioned each person in line as they approached. He passed their ID cards off to a similarly dressed officer, a commander of some sort, who stood slightly to the side, staring blankly into the glow of his electronic goggles as he scanned the cards that were handed to him. The third safety officer was a guard of the yellow tag variety, barely old enough to shave. He apparently didn't rate a helmet and was wearing a scratched hard hat with the York Emergency Authority logo stamped into the front. On one arm, he held a chipped police riot shield. The rest of his mismatched clothes made him look as though he had fought a battle to defend a Salvation Army and lost. The first two pedestrians were green-tagged professionals, so well-dressed that they didn't bother to wear their passes. Evelyn slowed unconsciously as she approached the checkpoint queue, as if the soldiers would tire and decide to leave before she reached it. Instead, she simply became the last person in line. By the time she reached the queue, the people in suits had passed through. Two people in regular clothes had been quietly detained and placed on the bus. Its diesel engine had been shut off to save fuel. She could see through a window that one detainee, a woman in her 60s, was shivering slightly near the back of the bus. The line moved forward, and an old man a few paces in front of Evelyn reached the officers.
"I've already gone through two checkpoints this morning," he complained. "You can't open new checkpoints wherever you please."
"Sir, that was a Homeland Patrol checkpoint," said the second in command. "More than one company has a franchise in this neighborhood. Please show me your proof of health card."
"I want to go through," insisted the man. "Soldiers stopping people in the streets. We have civil rights in this country."
The commander seized the man's wrist.
"Sir, everyone has a right to fair triage by a qualified expert, and we're not soldiers. We're public safety officers. Show me your papers, or I'll have to take you in for triage."
The man tried to pull away, began shouting. The other guards promptly handcuffed him and hustled him onto the bus. The commander flipped up his goggles for a moment to rifle through a cloth bag the old man had dropped. Evelyn could see it was full of groceries.
"Contraband," said the commander in triumph, waving a bruised-looking banana.
He flipped his goggles back down and snapped a photo with them.
"No wonder he wouldn't cooperate."
He confiscated the groceries and placed them in a locker built into the side of the bus. The commander turned on a voice amplifier in his helmet, unnecessarily since only three people still waited to pass the checkpoint, and addressed them.
"People, we don't want any trouble. I need you to have valid papers in your hands. Be ready to have your bag searched. If you don't want to do that here, we can take you down to the triage station and do it there."
Evelyn double-checked her new green ID and her proof of health card, which bore a recent and valid stamp. As she waited, a Homeland Patrol truck drove past the checkpoint on the far side. Its driver flashed armor security, a middle finger. The two guards returned from putting the old man on the bus and began searching the person at the front of the line. The man directly in front of Evelyn, bundled up in a high-collared black coat, cloth mask, and knitted watch cap, began to sidle sideways slightly, fiddling with the straps on his backpack. The youngest soldier noticed and raised his riot shield slightly.
"Sir, I need you to stay in line," he said.
The man in the high collar muttered an excuse about being late for a meeting. The young soldier stepped right up to the man, pushing his chipped riot shield into the man's face. The man stepped backward, nearly stepping on Evelyn's shoes.
The soldier shouted, "Don't give me any trouble!" There was a sudden, sharp scuffle. The young soldier was thrown to the pavement and across Evelyn's feet, knocking her backward onto the ground. Evelyn saw the man with the high collar pivot away from her and toward the commander. She heard a sharp bang and flinched. The officer's goggles shattered, and he fell to the ground. The black-clad man pivoted again. Evelyn saw he had a pistol and shot the next officer twice in the chest. The man in the coat spun back around, and for an instant, Evelyn had a glimpse of his dark and deep-set eyes. The man held his gun on the young soldier, who stared back wide-eyed from the ground. The man in black took a few deep, heavy breaths as he held the guard in the sights of his pistol. Then he turned and ran through the checkpoint. As the man's footfalls faded, the young soldier groaned, rolling into a fetal position and pulling his riot shield over himself like a blanket. Evelyn tried to sit up. She heard a tearing sound, felt something tug at the back of her jacket. She realized that she had fallen back onto the coil of razor wire. She slid away from it, to the sound of tearing cloth, and sprawled on the pavement, gasping in shock. Her head spun. She stared up at the slate-gray sky as snow started to fall. Somewhere, an alarm began to whine. The sheep were out again. Addie could see tufts of wool they'd left on the fence wires as they squeezed underneath. The electric fence charger had failed, no doubt. Addie scanned the frosty fields nearby, and then the border of woods along the pasture. She saw no sheep, but there was a track of disturbed grass leading north. The sheep must have snuck out of their paddock to find winter forage, oyster mushrooms, perhaps, or some clearing with an ungrazed thatch of yellowed grass.
"Adelaide," called a voice nearby.
Addie turned and smiled. "Carlos," she greeted him. He jogged toward her from the cluster of buildings that made up the farmstead.
"Fence is off," he said. "Sheep went up the ridge."
"So I see.
We'd better catch them before they walk off a cliff."
Addie grabbed a shepherd's crook from a nearby fence post and, with Carlos, walked swiftly toward the forested ridge. The weather was well suited to chasing sheep. The frozen ground was firm, and there was just enough frost to follow the flock's footprints. In a few minutes, they neared the small flock of sheep, who were snuffling curiously near a copse of oak trees. The sheep nosed under a layer of fallen leaves, now frozen and crunchy. Addie and Carlos slowed so as not to startle them.
"You get the ram by the collar," whispered Carlos, "and then I'll..."
He trailed off and furrowed his brow as he looked into the distance. Addie grabbed his sleeve and pulled him back gently behind a cedar. She could make out a figure less than 100 meters away. She heard footfalls on the frosted leaves, slightly uneven. She wished for a pair of binoculars. Her breath hung in the air as she stared.
"YEA scout?"
whispered Carlos, staring wide-eyed at the approaching figure.
"We haven't seen a drone in weeks," said Addie.
The figure wasn't wearing a uniform and seemed to be alone. Addie guessed it was a woman. The figure stared at the ground as they walked, face obscured by a hood. The stranger was getting close, nearly to the sheep. Addie stepped out from behind the cedar tree, ignoring Carlos's hissed discouragement.
"Hello?"
she called softly, then louder.
"Hello?"
The face snapped up. A woman, indeed, but her face was smeared with dirt, and she was bleeding from several scratches under her right eye. A few drops of blood were frozen to her collar, still bright red.
"Please," the woman said, "I need your help."
Addie stepped closer and reached out to take the woman's hand. Evelyn finally arrived at the triage administration building barely an hour before closing time, having been delayed and questioned at the checkpoint as a witness to 2 homicides. She was met by a friendly, blue-gloved receptionist in the main foyer of the limestone building. "The director likes to meet all the new employees," the receptionist explained. The receptionist ushered Evelyn upstairs. On the way, they passed several fashionably dressed employees of the triage administration. The walls sported hand sanitizer stations and official posters blazoned with slogans. "Tropical fruits carry tropical disease. proclaimed the banner above an illustration of bananas and pineapples radiating cartoon stink lines. Everyone has the right to fair triage by an expert, promised a picture of a smiling citizen being examined by a doctor. Information hygiene prevents digital epidemics, read the caption beneath a man tossing a mobile phone into a fire. The receptionist paused at the threshold of the director's office and pointed a blue finger at the green ID card clipped to Evelyn's collar. "Hun, you don't need to wear your green tag in the green zone," the receptionist said in a hushed voice. "Everyone knows if you're here, you belong here." Evelyn blushed slightly and tucked the card into her pocket. "He'll call you in when he's ready." Evelyn took a seat and waited, still shivering slightly from the day's events. A YEA radio program played quietly through speakers in the ceiling.
"Record-breaking warm weather in December brought relief to households dealing with the high price of charcoal," said a woman's voice. "I guess global warming wasn't so bad after all," answered a man.
"You said it, Jack. In light of the good news, fuel rations will be reduced this month by 5 liters. The man took over.
700 people are dead in Cairo after food riots yesterday morning. Police blamed the riots on leftist agitators. And fresh news today on last week's shootout between a terrorist cell and members of armor security. Forensic investigators found a hidden cache in a nearby building filled with guns, grenades, and illegal drugs. The block has been rezoned as red until it can be properly searched."
A muscular, middle-aged man with a turtleneck and a shaved head approached Evelyn. She stood quickly, nervously. "Good afternoon, Director Jess," she began, but he snorted, shook his head at her mistaken assumption, and waved her into the director's office. The actual director was in his 50s. He was tall. His thick black hair had bursts of gray at the temples. He smiled broadly and, to her surprise, gave Evelyn a bare-handed handshake as he welcomed her into his office. His hand was warm and soft. He didn't let go after the handshake, but held her hand for an extended moment as he looked down at her face.
"Welcome to triage administration," he said. Then he frowned slightly. "You're trembling. There's no need to be nervous."
His smile returned.
"We don't bite."
She pried her hand away gently and averted her eyes. "It's just that I witnessed a shooting on the way over. 2 security guards, so I'm a bit
shaken up,"
he finished.
"Oh, my dear, have a seat."
He put a hand on her shoulder and guided her to a chair by his desk. The director smelled faintly of some cologne Evelyn found pleasant. He called to someone outside his office door and gestured, one hand still on her shoulder. He sighed loudly as she sat.
"Terrorists and criminals," he said, shaking his head. "What a horrible thing. And I see they tore your jacket. Animals."
He examined the tear in the back of her jacket, where layers of red felt could be seen through the dark outer shell. Evelyn's partner had sewn many layers of warm felt into the breathable polymer coat. It was cozy in the fall. It couldn't keep out gusts on truly cold days, but felt was better than sheets of newspaper.
"I hope you weren't questioned for long," said the director.
"My triage administration transfer."
"Of course,"
he smiled.
"Even the dimmest security contractor knows we are their bread and butter. When we're around, even armor and homeland pretend to get along."
The receptionist entered the office and placed a steaming espresso cup in front of Evelyn. Evelyn sipped at it tentatively, then looked up at her new boss.
"Is this
real coffee?"
He nodded with a smile.
"Despite the ongoing emergency, despite fungal diseases in the tropical plantations, we try to live life as normally as possible. People work hard here, Evelyn, but we are rewarded."
He went to the opposite side of the desk and sat. He gave her an appraising look for such a long time that Evelyn began to feel uncomfortable. She focused on the rich flavor of her coffee.
"Evelyn, do you understand what we do here?"
He didn't wait for her to respond.
"We assess need and assign limited resources. We have an important job. Our society is sick, you see. Not just physical maladies. A sickness of the soul. Your unfortunate experience today," he waved his fingers at her coat, "is only one symptom.
Our people had once prosperity. Some of us work hard to restore a society with strong bodies and sharp minds. But others, he sneered slightly, others are unwilling to work, to make the sacrifices we need for progress. He looked her directly in the eye. Our job is to know the difference, to separate those who will help restore the health and well-being of our nation from the people who are too sick to do it any good, those who must be quarantined.
For treatment, she said, to get them the help they need.
Yes, he said, for their own good. I'm glad you understand. Normally I would do a brief interview, but let's leave that for another day. Stanley will show you around the building.
He stood and beckoned to the stocky man with the shaven head from the office threshold. Evelyn drained her last mouthful of coffee and stood as well. The director strode around the desk, putting a hand on the tear in her jacket.
Let me give you a welcoming present. Stanley, would you please have Miss Park measured for a new jacket?
She tried to protest, but he silenced her.
We have resources here that other divisions don't. It's nothing. I'll see you soon.
Stanley jerked his head to indicate that she should follow. She did, noticing the offices were warmer and better lit than she was used to. She removed her jacket. If every floor was so warm, she wouldn't even have to wear a second sweater at her desk. So, Stanley, are you a tailor? She asked in an attempt to make conversation. He snorted derisively and shook his head. As they passed doors and intersecting corridors, Stanley muttered a word or two.
Case processing, he growled tersely at one door. Statistics, at another. Requisitioning, communication, information hazards, electronic countermeasures.
They descended a stairwell near the rear of the building.
Cafeteria.
He waved one floor down. Evelyn's stomach growled at the scent of cooking food. Rumor was that portions at triage administration were so generous that staff took home leftovers. It would make a difference for Sid as he grew. They passed through a heavy basement door.
Triage archives.
He pointed left, but turned right, through a door labeled surplus storage. Inside was a small office where several women consulted clipboards and updated spreadsheets on archaic computers. One of them looked up, a middle-aged brunette with tired eyes and a conservative hairstyle.
Take her to measurements, Stanley said brusquely. Winter coat, warm, something classy.
The brunette woman produced a clothier's tape and measured Evelyn with practice proficiency. Then she disappeared through a back door. Evelyn caught a glimpse of racks of clothing, bolts of fabric, row upon row of shelving. There was an awkward quiet. The two remaining women tapped at their keyboards in rapid staccato without looking up. After a few minutes, the brown-haired woman returned and shook her head.
Nothing in that size today, she said.
So find something, said Stanley as he walked toward the door.
We'll try tomorrow, the woman answered.
Will a new shipment be coming in tomorrow? Evelyn asked as she followed Stanley up the stairs. Imports from Europe? Uncomfortable with the continued silence, she pressed. Or the Protectorate? Or somewhere else? Stanley stopped on the stairs so suddenly that she almost ran into him. Then he turned slightly toward her without making eye contact.
Surplus,
he muttered, and then he turned away and kept walking.
The walls of the long-abandoned dining room reverberated with her anger.
What the fuck do you think you were doing? She demanded.
Lath sat back in his chair and stared at her across the dimly lit table. She had a head of close-cropped gray hair and thick eyebrows. A scar above her left eyebrow intensified her gaze. She was a foot shorter than him, but standing with her palms firmly on the table, she loomed over him.
Do you realize that they red zoned 12 blocks after your little show? We've got half a dozen contacts trapped inside, and about 1,000 people without electricity or water. What were you thinking?
I had no choice, Lath answered. It was a surprise checkpoint. I was penned in.
So you shot 3 people? Demanded the woman.
Lath unzipped his backpack and dumped out its contents. Shrink-wrapped packages clunked heavily onto the table. A few contained small-caliber ammunition coated in translucent machine oil. Another held rechargeable batteries, still in their original Japanese packaging. A third contained orange pill bottles, labeled neatly by hand. A fourth was full of small blank coins and labeled Samizdata. Another held rolls of cash wrapped with rubber bands.
I shot two people, he corrected, and I only had one chance to get this cash, X. Armbands were searching the whole block, building by building. If I waited any longer...
She inspected the packages, picked up the bag holding rolls of $100 bills, and threw it on the floor next to a pile of empty soy sauce containers.
I wish you had left the cash and retrieved things of value.
There were no more valuables, Leif answered. The caches were nearly empty. Even the grenades were gone.
X shook her head.
Damned cowboy, she sighed. This is what happens when you put a meathead in charge of a resistance cell. That idiot gets them all machine-gunned, but not before using up most of my supplies. Felicity!
A young woman with a notebook entered the room. X swept the material to the edge of the table with one arm and sat. Felicity joined them at the table and counted the supplies, making brief and cryptic notes. After a moment, Leif pulled a foil-wrapped pouch out of his pocket and threw it on the table.
Oh, and there were these, he added, alibis.
X opened the foil packet and dumped out a small stack of unflashed white ID tags. Their digital ink displays were blank, their embedded RFIDs fresh and empty.
Well, she said, I guess that's something.
Are all these antibiotics? Felicity asked. No gansufloxacin, no multispec V?
Leith shook his head. Felicity and X exchanged brief looks of concern. X tapped an index finger thoughtfully on her formidable nose, then spoke. Her voice was softer.
I'm glad you made it out in one piece, Leith. I'm glad you retrieved this cash. But do I need to remind you how grim things are? We're running out of basic supplies. We lost 7 people this week alone.
Leith grimaced.
I know.
We need to be careful, X told him. We need to be more subtle than ever. Now give me the blow-by-blow.
He gave an account of his day, rising before sunset to be on the street at the lift of curfew, sneaking into the Target building through an abandoned cargo door to get to the cache, traveling through alleys and hidden corridors to avoid detection, only to be stopped by a surprise checkpoint a few blocks from home. Shooting 2 soldiers and leaving the last one, merely a boy, alive. Sneaking to the boarded-up Chinese restaurant and reporting to X. X nodded.
Okay, go rest.
Leith stood to leave.
But if you have to fight your way out again, X said, be sure to shoot them all.
Did he hit you? Addie asked. The woman across the table hesitated.
He waved his fists. He threatened, but he didn't actually hit anyone.
What happened to your face? Asked Addie. The scratches on the woman's face were stark red in the late afternoon sunlight that flooded the farmhouse kitchen.
I walked into a thorn branch on the way here.
Did he tell you to leave his land? Or did you choose to leave by yourself?
He said to leave, the woman said. Said we weren't working hard enough. Said we ate too much. That if we weren't gone by sunset, he would drag us out himself.
Addie nodded thoughtfully, pouring the woman a cup of tea from the pot on the kitchen table. Beside her, Carlos took notes, his calloused hand moving slowly across the sheet of paper as he wrote compactly with a pencil stub. A fire crackled softly in the kitchen wood stove. What did you take with you? Addie asked.
Just what I own, the woman replied,
nodding at a small backpack by the door, a pair of worn winter boots, a patched coat on a hook.
The others went to Newbrook with the clothes on their backs.
Sandra, did he give you a share of dried goods, money, anything? Asked Addie. Sandra sipped from her tea, then shook her head.
He said we owed him money for room and board. Said we were bums if I couldn't pay it. Said we owed him for hosting us when I grew half their food.
Addie nodded, frowning. That's all we need for now. Why don't you warm up here for a few minutes, then we'll find your old spot in the women's bunkhouse. Sandra sniffled, looked grateful, and thanked her. Addie stood, and Carlos followed her lead, tucking his notepaper into a folder on a bookshelf. They donned their coats and stepped outside of the farmhouse. The leaves scattered across the yellow grass were brown and dead, free of snow but coated with frost. The air smelled faintly of wood smoke. Oblique daylight grew red as the sun neared the horizon. They walked around the corner of the barn, which was painted with an enormous faded image of a thistle. Carlos scratched his beard and spoke softly.
Do you believe her?
Of course I do, said Addie. A woman doesn't walk 3 hours across frozen fields in the middle of the winter for a place in a crowded bunkhouse if she has another option. Don't you think she's telling the truth?
I'm afraid she's telling the truth, said Carlos. We fed Bill Farnham's children for an entire winter. We built them a hand pump and a windmill. We sent them trained homesteaders to board and to work the land. Hell, I planted a willow grove on his farm myself, and now he's kicking out our boarders? His family wouldn't have made it through the last 10 years without us.
People forget quickly, Addie sighed. They grow their own food for a few years, and suddenly they don't need the thistle anymore.
They still aren't growing their own food. If we hadn't sent them workers this summer, they'd barely have anything in the cellar, he vented. But now that it's winter, he's charging our people rent. He never even had to pay them. It was mutual aid.
They followed a footpath along a cedar rail fence. A few horses stood on the far side of it, nosing at a pile of hay. The path crossed a small bridge over a shallow stream. The stream bed was wide and rocky, only a trickle of water flowed between icy stones. We should go down there tomorrow, said Addie, for his side of the story.
I can tell you what he'll say, Carlos replied. It's his land and he can do what he wants with it.
That farm was Haudenosaunee land a few centuries ago, said Addie. I guess it still is, rightfully. But Farnham signed a land-sharing agreement with us 8 years ago. The YEA land registry probably lists that farm as government property due to unpaid taxes. She chuckled. Probably the only person who thinks that land belongs to Bill Farnham is Bill Farnham himself. Carlo snorted. Past the stream, there was a steep hill covered in small willow saplings. The willows could be cut at ground level every few years. Each stem would regenerate into one or two or three new stems the following year. The young, flexible willow stems were turned into baskets, fencing, medicine, and kindling. Addie and Carlos climbed the path as it switchbacked up the hill through the willows.
We should talk to the community militia first thing tomorrow, said Carlos. Send a brigade with horses. Tell them, honor the agreement, or we take all the food our people grew.
Addie smiled. That's appealing, but premature. Let's try diplomacy first. Besides, Lieutenant Dumont is out on patrol for another few days.
I'm not joking, said Carlos. I'm serious, Adelaide. You let these guys start breaking their agreements, soon enough we'll have landlords and serfs everywhere. You're the one who always warns about feudalism. We've got to nip this in the bud.
You're not wrong, she admitted, but let's not be hasty. She took his hand. They reached the top of the hill. Past the crest, the trees ended abruptly. On their left was a 50-foot tower topped by a wind turbine, spinning slowly in the breeze. On their right was a small bench beside a tool shed. In front of them was a 70-foot drop into a vast crater that stretched kilometers into the distance. Its opposite wall was the horizon. They sat on the bench and stared out at the expanse of bedrock and pools of icy water before them. Carlos leaned toward Addie, who turned and kissed him on the lips before looking back toward the sunset.
I still can't get over the sight of this, Addie sighed. How the hell did we let things get this bad?
Chapter 2 2028
There are 400 people here today, Helen yelled into the megaphone.
The people of Newbrook are sending a clear message to this government about what we want for our future. We will not let you risk the health of our community's children. We will not let you poison the land. And we will not tolerate companies that put profit before people.
The crowd roared its approval. Helen lowered the megaphone and stepped down from the bed of the pickup truck she had been standing on. The crowd began chanting, "People before profits," and marched slowly forward along the fence of a petroleum depot, its decrepit tanks looming in the distance. A journalist called Helen's name to ask for a few quick photos in front of the fence. She obliged, somewhat reluctantly, brandishing her megaphone as the journalist snapped photos, the rusted white cylinders of the tank farm in the background.
"Can you tell me why your group is marching around the tank farm today?" the journalist asked, scribbling on a tiny notepad.
"This petroleum depot was closed in the first place because it was a hazard," Helen replied, launching into a well-rehearsed soundbite. "It was cheaper to shut it down than repair the leaks. It's ludicrous to reopen it at a time when we must move away from harmful fossil fuels." She pointed across the road. "And putting an environmental hazard like this across the street from an active elementary school is dangerous and irresponsible."
The journalist finished writing and thanked her. He didn't need to check her name or its spelling. The tank farm story had been in the newspaper every week for months. Helen stepped back onto the hot asphalt of the street, rejoining the body of the march as it circumnavigated the petroleum depot. She weaved through the crowd to catch up with her fellow organizers. A few of them were busily tapping at their phones, while others led chants or waved banners.
"Helen," Elijah called, looking up from his phone. "Good news and bad news. What do you want first?"
"Good," she said.
"We got the documents from the latest Freedom of Information request back. It's full of useful info about industrial revitalization. I'm going back to the office to check it out."
"What's the bad news?"
"They're trying to roll this tank farm redevelopment into a larger state-sponsored project."
"Fuck," said Helen.
"There's a press conference live streaming right now."
"Let's all meet after to watch it," said Helen.
"See you then,"
Elijah said, returning to his phone screen. Helen threaded her way to the front of the march, where their pilot vehicle, the pickup truck from which she had given her short speech, was slowly leading the way. A few of the march participants who couldn't or didn't want to walk the whole way were sitting on bales of straw in the back. Helen walked up to the open driver's side door.
"Howdy, Helen," said the woman in the driver's seat.
"How's the driving, Gwen?" Helen asked.
"We have some company," Gwen replied, nodding her head forward.
A police cruiser, lights flashing, had placed itself at the front of the procession, an unrequested escort.
"Hopefully they won't give us trouble," said Helen.
"Maybe," said Gwen in a cheerfully doubtful tone, "but some people might be looking for it."
She glanced into her side mirror and jerked her thumb backward. Helen looked. Some of the younger, black-clad protesters had decided to expand the width of the march from one lane to two. Their expansion into the opposing lane was being impeded by a pair of bicycle cops who pedaled alongside the march.
"Tavi,"
said Helen, shaking her head.
"You need to stay in your lane," the bicycle cop told Tavi, "for your own safety."
Tavi rolled his eyes.
"There are hundreds of people here. We need both lanes." "This march doesn't have a permit for two lanes," the cop replied.
He got off his bike and parked it diagonally in front of Tavi, as if to funnel him back into the main march. Tavi just walked around him on the outside.
"This march doesn't have a permit at all," said Tavi. "If you want to make us safe, stop cars from driving right beside the march. There are little kids here."
"Don't bother talking to him,"
said Andy, who had emerged from the march to walk beside Tavi.
"It's no use talking to cops."
A young woman followed him out. Samantha wore dark clothing, like Tavi and Andy, but her hoodie was densely packed with political patches and buttons.
"Come on, people, take the whole street,"
Samantha shouted to the crowd. She waved her arms to beckon. A few people began to follow them across the yellow line into the opposing lane.
"Stop doing that," said the bicycle cop. "You're inciting a misdemeanor."
Andy responded with a middle finger.
"I could arrest you for making lewd gestures."
The cop grabbed Tavi, who was closest, by the sleeve.
But by this time, several dozen people had crossed into the lane, including a number of middle-aged, middle-class-looking people. Their disapproving glances made the cop release his grip. As the march approached its endpoint, Tavi and the others decided to quietly slip away rather than linger with the dwindling crowd and a growing number of police at the rally point. They walked nonchalantly up onto the sidewalk and then cut between two buildings to emerge in a parking lot out of sight of the departing march.
"Hey, you're under arrest," shouted a voice.
The bicycle cop. He had seen them depart and followed them to the next street. The trio ignored him and kept walking, but the route was promptly cut off by a police cruiser with flashing lights. A second cruiser was speeding toward them down the street.
"Shit," said Tavi.
"How do you know you can trust me?" he asked. Dee stared evenly at the young man across the table from her.
She had chosen the meeting time and location carefully. One had to be cautious when hiring a hacker to penetrate a powerful network of companies. The Lucky Lion Cafe was packed, in the midst of its Saturday morning brunch rush. Dee had arrived an hour early to scout the place, had spent 10 minutes watching the young man from across the room after he arrived. Watched him order green tea and a peanut butter cookie, as she had instructed him to, before she approached. Dee considered his question thoughtfully. How did she know she could trust him? The answer was not straightforward. When Dee was 4 years old, her family's minivan was in a 10-car highway pileup. Her mother and two siblings died within minutes. Dee's father, who was on one of his frequent business trips overseas, returned to find her in the ICU. She was unconscious for 3 days. Sitting at the bedside of his one surviving child, Dee's father vowed never again to be away from her. They recovered slowly together. Dee's father had been almost 40 when he met Dee's mother, nearly 50 at the time of the crash. He had no interest in remarrying. Dee became the center of his life, and he the center of hers. So when Dee's father began to work again, to travel, he took her with him. Her father's job title was Fair Trade Prospector. He traveled around the world trying to find new products that were almost ready to be put on the global market as ethical products. Once he found them, he used his connections to call on investors and distributors and marketers. He helped popularize shea butter from Mali. He got funding to create the second largest coffee cooperative in Costa Rica. Over 5 years, the investors he brought in doubled the export of fair trade certified handicrafts from Bangladesh, where his family was from. Dee's father homeschooled her some of the time, but she could not remember doing a single exercise out of a textbook. He taught her to read with posters and newspapers and travel brochures in half a dozen different languages. He taught her math by letting her spend rupees and francs and pesos at street vendors and cafes around the globe. He encouraged her to write down her thoughts in journals, to photograph or draw the things she saw in Sydney or Bangkok or Caracas. Critical thinking she learned from her father's constant questioning of potential business prospects. Can production really be scaled up? Will delivery deadlines be met? Is the product consistent and uniform enough for international sale? Later, as her father's business sense paid off and his early investments matured into real wealth, she learned from him a deeper form of introspection as he agonized over who benefited most from the deals he brokered between international capitalists and subsistence farmers. For social studies, the world was her textbook. By the time she was 12, Dee had met and interacted with a greater variety of human beings than 99% of the people on the planet ever would. She could speak 3 languages with reasonable fluency, but she could communicate with almost anyone. She learned to read faces, body language, and the nuances of vocal tone. With her father's help, she learned to dig deeper. From expression and emotion, she could derive character. Her father had made so many business deals through interpreters that he learned to judge whether a person was honest or trustworthy without words. Soon, she could do the same, and by her teen years, she had surpassed her father. So when Simone, the hacker, asked how she knew he was trustworthy, she almost laughed. How could she not? She nodded at one of the tablet users at an adjacent table. "That computer, how fast is it?" He scoffed.
"Very slow. Older dual-core processor underclocked to stretch out battery life. An integrated graphics, so..."
And you could tell this just by looking at it?
He nodded. I know the make and model, but humans aren't manufactured. You can't tell what's inside by looking at the outside.
She glanced at another patron of the cafe, an older man likewise reading on a tablet.
Can I run any software I want on that thing?
He frowned.
That's iOS, so everything is locked down and approved, but that's...
Both of those machines just look like black rectangles to me. I couldn't tell them apart if I were holding them. But you can tell from a distance what's inside of them. Look at the screen to tell what software is running.
You can tell from the window chrome that...
See, I don't even know what that means, she interrupted. But the way you tell from a glance what's going on inside a computer, it's the same for me with people, from their body language and their faces. I could watch a video of us having this conversation and tell that you are trustworthy even with the sound muted.
She could sometimes tell even more without the sound. Words could obscure true feelings.
But you look like a teenager, he said.
My apparent youth is exactly how I avoid detection, she said simply. There was an awkward silence as she gazed at him without elaborating.
Did you bring the,
He glanced around the room in a manner that was obviously conspiratorial.
Materials?
Underneath the table, she had placed a backpack containing $2,000 and an encrypted USB key with further instructions and a list of targets. She had asked him to bring an identical backpack, empty. The deposit is there, she replied. Once you finish these jobs, I'll have more business for you. She shifted in her seat, getting ready to stand. This is the only time we'll ever meet in person. Before she could stand, he reached partway across the table, stopped short of actually touching her.
I just want you to know, I'm not just in this for the money, he said. I want to work with your organization. I believe in what you're doing. If there's more I can help with.
She picked up the empty backpack and stood to go. I'll pass it on to the higher-ups, she said with a tight smile. I'm just a courier. When Tavi got home to his basement apartment that night, his mother was waiting.
Where have you been? It's so late,
she said the moment he came through the door.
I went to the protest, Mom, he replied.
That was hours ago. I saw you on TV arguing with a cop, she said. He rolled his eyes as he took his shoes off.
Yeah, we got arrested, so that's why I'm late.
Geez, Tavi, you got arrested? She said.
You'll never get a job with a criminal record.
Tavi was parched, so went to their tiny kitchen and opened the fridge. He poured himself a glass of soy milk.
It's those friends of yours, she said. Everyone else got a summer job after graduation.
Mom, the unemployment rate for youth is like 30%. The rest have jobs so boring they want to kill themselves or get drunk every night. This was a conversation that they had repeated many times in different variations.
Your friend Samantha did the vegetable growing thing for the city. Can't you do that?
His mother asked. That was a summer program for high school students, Mom, he replied.
Tavi, you need structure in your life. You need something to do other than stay up late. You know, if you had a steady job, the girls would respect you more, or the boys, or whatever.
Oh my God, Mom.
Not that there's anything wrong with seeing boys or girls, but your father wishes you'd make up your mind.
Tavi slapped his own forehead.
Mom, you're sharing relationship advice from the guy you divorced?
Tavi shook his head and walked toward his bedroom.
I printed out some job ads and left them on the table, she called.
Tavi went into his room and closed the door more quickly and more loudly than necessary. Dee took 4 different buses and 3 subway routes on her way home. She employed her usual counter-surveillance techniques, jumping on and off buses, paying fares in cash, donning or removing cloth face masks of various colors, changing jackets in crowded subway cars, taking a detour through a mall. So it was well after supper when she arrived home. She put the battery back into her phone as she walked up the driveway. When she arrived, her father was asleep on the couch. The television was on, showing a nature documentary about kangaroos. She turned the volume down, waking her father.
Adida, he smiled, how was the library?
It was good, she said, sitting down beside him and hugging him. I got a lot done.
I tried to call you about dinner, he said,
his face looking drawn and pale,
but it went to voicemail.
My phone ran out of battery, she lied.
Ah, my brilliant daughter, he said with genuine love on his face. who memorized a French phrasebook in 90 minutes but can't remember to charge her phone. I ordered Chinese. Leftovers are in the fridge.
She went into their house's large kitchen and pulled the cardboard containers from the fridge. She frowned. The food was from the Lucky Lion, where she had met Simone. It was most unlucky to have a personal connection to a place where she had held a clandestine rendezvous. She made a mental note to never again visit the Lucky Lion. In the fridge, there were also two older bags of takeout that had been pushed to the back. Dee sniffed them, then threw them in the garbage. Dee microwaved a plate of chicken fried rice and went to sit beside her father. He had switched the television to the news.
Your morning cup of joe could get a lot more expensive if agronomists can't control a new coffee fungus spread by global warming, warned the anchor.
Few of the stories were what Dee would consider good news. A dispute in the East China Sea after a Japanese warship collided with a Filipino fishing boat. A court battle in which the White House was trying to limit Chinese investment in North American energy infrastructure. Climate-induced crop failures in four countries. An increase in outbreaks of antibiotic-resistant tuberculosis. Glowing coverage of how warrantless vehicle tracking by police was a net gain for public safety. There was an interesting story about a community fighting to keep a decrepit petroleum depot closed to protect groundwater.
That might be a good cause to donate to, Adita, her father said. You could look into the Friends of the Watershed.
I'll do that, Dee said. I just made a donation to a government transparency researcher. Simone, the hacker, would be amused to hear himself described in such terms. But I was also thinking more about that idea we talked about, the fair trade cafe with the bookstore.
You know I like the idea of you starting a business, Adita, her father said. It's important not to be complacent, not to live off the money we already have. But a bookstore, in this day and age, no one buys books anymore.
It wouldn't be just paper books, she said. There would be tablets and e-readers. We would recommend books, sell hardware, set people up. I know people who can run it. They just need some seed money and a signer for the building rental.
If that's what you want, I'll support you, her father said. You could wait until you were older, but why waste time? Life is short. I wish I hadn't waited so long to have you. Sometimes getting a job done will take just as much time as you give yourself.
Dee nodded. I'll look at some venues tomorrow.
All right, he said. But I want to see a business plan by the end of the week.
They went back to watching the news. A few minutes later, he was asleep. Looking at his face, Dee could see he had lost more weight. She pulled a blanket over him and went to her room to review her long list of action items. After the march, Helen and the other organizers sat down at the Friends of the Watershed office to watch video of the government press conference. On the screen, a state spokesman stood confidently at a podium, business suit, immaculate, blue tie, iridescent, with full Windsor knot, blonde hair, carefully brushed and neatly parted, shutters clicked, flash bulbs strobed irregularly.
We've had a tough few years in this country. The spokesman said, hard-working people have lost their jobs. Everyone has struggled to make ends meet. But our government is here with a solution that will bring prosperity back to our country, that will stimulate our economy while creating thousands of new jobs, that will lower energy prices and make consumer goods more affordable by enabling us to make our own energy right here at home.
A hand-picked audience of supporters applauded loudly.
The Industrial Revitalization Initiative will invest billions of dollars. It will expand the infrastructure we need to supply fuel and electricity to our growing cities. It will provide good, stable employment for many years to come.
More applause.
And it will bypass the crippling environmental and zoning legislation that has caused our country to fall behind in the global marketplace.
Generous applause came over the speakers.
By using advanced forms of clean coal and hydraulic fracturing, we can obtain the energy that our country runs on. New, safer pipelines will bring crude from the oil sands for refining and manufacturing in our own backyards. tax breaks for job creators, and a streamlined approval process for new industrial facilities will ensure that construction can begin now, when we need it, to keep the engines running, the lights on, and the future bright for our children. Thunderous applause.
The image froze, and the applause went silent.
I think we've all heard enough, said Helen. She turned to the others, Tom, Gwen, Teresa, Elijah, and Apollo, for their thoughts.
Same old talking points, said Tom. Jobs, technology, stimulus. A few people will get shitty jobs for a few years, and then they'll be back in the unemployment line with more benzene in their bloodstreams.
The scale is new, said Teresa. He looks polished, as always, but I think they're really panicking this time. Their poll numbers are starting to look as bad as a NASDAQ. A chuckle passed through the room.
I don't want to be a party pooper, kids, drawled Gwen, but this is a big thing to take on. Shouldn't we focus on the tank farm fight? I mean, we're run ragged just organizing marches and petitions and town hall meetings and whatnot.
That's why I wanted to talk while I have you all together, said Helen. I'll be quick, but here's the executive summary.
Helen clicked a key, and a map appeared on the projector screen. It was highly detailed and centered on an area around the Great Lakes.
This is Elijah's best guess of what the IRI will look like, said Helen, gesturing to the screen. Not all of it has been publicly announced, and some ongoing projects will be folded in, but you get the gist.
The map was color-coded. Upgraded electrical lines were rendered in a deep blue, spiderwebbing out from the cities. Planned pipelines were red, tentacular clusters with thick nodes at industrial parks and factories connected to fracking sites. New industrial extraction sites were shaded yellow, some of them bigger than the towns and villages they neighbored.
So this is what our enemy looks like, said Apollo.
Helen suppressed a frown. She admired Apollo's ability to zero in on pressure points to find places of leverage, but she was sometimes repelled by his adversarial attitude. Apollo continued.
Big isn't always bad. They can't defend every industrial site. The more places they have to work, the more places we can show up and cause a ruckus.
We're all busy, Gwen, said Teresa. But this project is huge. It affects the integrity of everything, soil, water, air, biodiversity. If we stop the tank farm but don't stop this... Teresa trailed off and shrugged.
I don't disagree, kid, said Gwen. But I'd rather focus on a cause we agree on than stretch ourselves too thin and fall apart.
That's a concern for me, too, said Helen. If we want to organize a bigger coalition to take this on, we should start soon, before they build up too much momentum. Focus on the petroleum depot, but keep IRI in the long view. What do you think?
We fight it, said Apollo. What else can we do?
Tom nodded in agreement and joined in the chorus.
God knows what kind of future we'll leave for our kids if we don't.
Chapter 3 2051. Laith sat across the table from X in the boarded-up restaurant. An old fluorescent light flickered faintly overhead.
You must be joking, said Laith, scrunching his nose in disgust. A Catholic priest? Are we that desperate for allies?
The Catholic Church has a mixed history of social justice, X replied. When the European Old Guard was gutted by epidemics, the ranks filled out with liberation theologists from the global south.
She paused.
And yes, we are that desperate for allies.
Is this priest heavily armed? Is he bringing us guns and rockets, grenades, antibiotics, medicine, or just a few copies of the good book?
X shifted uncomfortably in her chair and rubbed the scar above her eyebrow.
He's on a fact-finding mission.
Laith snorted, but X continued.
What he reports back to his superiors could win us supplies and support. In the Second World War, resistors snuck reports out of concentration camps to the Allies. You've never heard of Witold Pilecki?
Laith sighed. X was always like this. You couldn't win an argument. She would cite little-known, century-old examples. The only way to win was to list even more obscured counterexamples at even greater length, something that Felicity had accomplished twice, and Laith exactly zero times. He changed tack.
How am I supposed to do my job and handhold a Bible thumper?
Simple, she replied. Meet him upon his arrival, escort him without incident to his destination.
How do we know we can trust him?
We have assurances, X said, via Gertrude. Besides, Laith, there's a history of clergy supporting liberation movements. Think about the priests in Nazi-occupied Europe who helped smuggle refugees to freedom. All the American churches that protected Latinx refugees from deportation.
Catholic churches? Laith asked.
X waved that away. If you want to talk about the Catholic Church, look at the autonomous Catholic worker houses that campaigned against war and inequality for over a century, or the liberation theology movement in Latin America. Priests like Archbishop Romero in El Salvador, surely you know his story.
Laith sighed again and leaned back in his chair to indicate that he didn't. X leaned forward without breaking eye contact.
In the 1970s, a country of El Salvador was ruled by a right-wing military government. Grassroots social movements were fighting for basic human rights, labor unions, accessible health care, and freedom of expression. U.S.-backed death squads terrorized the poor and the left, imprisoning and torturing activists. One of the death squad leaders, trained by the U.S. military, was nicknamed Blowtorch Bob. Do I need to explain how he got that name?
Please don't.
Archbishop Romero spoke out against the death squads, called for compassion and relief for the poor, and people listened. He had a weekly radio show that was heard by half the country.
Laith raised an eyebrow.
So the death squads gave up?
In 1980, Romero gave a speech calling on government soldiers to heed the will of Jesus Christ and respect human rights, X said. Immediately afterward, he was assassinated in broad daylight by a U.S.-backed death squad. A quarter of a million people attended his funeral. It was the largest demonstration in the country's history.
Laith let out a slow breath and stared at the ceiling for a moment before he could look back at her.
And then things changed.
And then President Reagan sent the death squads more guns, replied X. Were you hoping for an easy victory? Things got worse before they got better. But they did get better, slowly. Point is, it's dangerous to do the right thing, even as a priest. So you'd better keep this priest safe.
What if it turns out we can't trust this priest?
Laith asked.
What if he turns out to be another infiltrator?
Then, after consulting me, ensure he can do our movement no harm, she replied.
Laith was silent.
I'll take that as agreement.
Laith said nothing. X stared at him for a long while.
We need to talk about what happened, about losing people.
We don't need to talk about it, said Laith.
He's dead, Laith. You'll have to accept that, she said. It's thin comfort, but it's better to know, in a way. Someone I was very close to, a lover, went to prison many years ago. He languished there, and when things got rough, he was simply disappeared.
I just want to get on with my next mission, he said without looking at her. We can talk about our feelings after we win.
She sighed.
There are still people in this movement you care about, yes?
Asked X.
So don't get reckless.
She reached into a folder and handed him a map.
Don't let the priest out of your sight until he's delivered. Success is essential. But his request is unusual. And dangerous.
Laith shrugged.
Where do I meet him?
Adelaide switched the radio to something classical and settled into the library alcove that served as her map room. Visitors were often surprised that the Thistle had a map room, but to Adelaide it made perfect sense. What better way to be situated on land, to know it deeply, than to map out past, present, and future? The main glass cabinet held archival surveys, charts of indigenous language families, the world as it had been. There were maps of colonial expansion, terrain scattered with farmsteads, churches, and mills. Maps of the farm showing crop rotation and grazing plans back to the 1960s. Delicately folded soil maps of rocky highlands bounded by long belts of sandy loam and low, flat zones of rich clay. Their details rendered obsolete by quarries. There were maps of the Thistle, each building outlined in black,
Fields and pastures, fence lines, buried pipes and wires. Maps of the Thistle's regional allies and intern placement programs, hand-drawn overtop county roadmaps from the 2010s. Climate maps showing record temperature increases and uneven precipitation. The wall above the cabinet contained Addie's attempt to compile a picture of the world as it had become, her cartography of the present, on three successive sliding cork panels. She flipped on a light to better see the maps, as outside, twilight faded to darkness. The first panel held a world map, sparsely annotated. She had tried to record major events and border changes since the map's printing in 2025. In green ink were a swath of early food riots across Latin America and Northern Africa, with subsequent riots encroaching into China and Eastern Europe. The most up-to-date annotations, yellowed by a decade of aging, reported populist and fascist coups along with outbreaks and epidemics. Borders sealed, she had noted on the fringes of China and the European Union. After that, news from far-flung places had become unreliable. Major independent news sources had been censored, shut down, or co-opted. She turned up the radio. Was that Stravinsky playing? And slid the world map aside to access the second panel, a map of North America. This map was more up to date. The western coastal region was outlined in red, showing the borders of the Chinese protectorate. An orange blob, a hand-drawn radiation symbol, obscured part of northern Alberta. The seceded states of Texas and Vermont, along with the former province of Quebec, were outlined in yellow. A few sovereign indigenous communities in the independent Dakota Territory were marked, as were a handful of UN peacekeeping bases that once dotted the eastern seaboard, though she doubted they were still present. She slid the panel to the third map, a detailed rendering of the Great Lakes region, along with the Northeast, formerly United, states. A blob of red encompassed the core cities of the York Emergency Authority. Addie had drawn concentric dotted lines showing the expansion of the authority's borders, documenting them as a physician might track the spread of sepsis. She also recorded the alignment of various municipalities and client cities under the sway of the authority, along with skirmishes between YEA forces and local rebels. Most such flare-ups were short-lived, but a few lingering hotspots persisted. Addie crossed her arms and stared, still contemplating this map, as a voice came over the radio.
You're listening to the official York Emergency Authority music channel, bringing you...
She reached out to tune the set to a different channel, but every station was either jammed, yielding only buzzing noise, or playing some official authority broadcast. She turned it off and went back to her map of the YEA front. Some minutes later, Carlos walked in.
10 years ago, the emergency authority was 300 kilometers away, he observed. Now they're triaging within 50 kilometers and making promises to landlords even closer.
He shook his head and rubbed his bearded jaw.
How many drone overflights have there been in the last year alone? Lieutenant Dumont says the numbers have tripled.
They must have half the city's garrison in the field to occupy so much territory, said Addie, obviously not afraid of an uprising at home.
Maybe they're too desperate for food and charcoal to worry about resistance in the city, said Carlos. At least they're still on the other side of the river.
Adelaide said nothing, just stared at the map, her eyes hooded.
These rent conflicts will be the least of our problems, he said. In a few years, maybe months, we'll have triage officers and soldiers in the village or walking right up our driveway. What are we going to do then?
The old dock still stunk of diesel, though Laith doubted the fuel tanks had been used in 20 years. A dead complex of concrete silos and warehousing loomed in the evening smog, barely visible in the deep blue light that penetrated the overcast sky. Laith squatted near a tangle of overturned shipping containers that had been rusting for nearly as long as he had been alive. At the appointed time, he heard the scrape of paddles along gunwales and a gentle swishing of water. He stood and stepped toward the icy dock. A moment later, he could see the canoe approaching, silent and dark, three shadows seated within. A figure at the bow grabbed the edge of the dock as they approached, but did not tie the boat up or step out, appropriately cautious in a city barely an hour from curfew. The figure in the middle climbed from the canoe onto the dock. Shouldering a bag, he whispered a few words to the people who had delivered him. Then he approached Laith and held out a hand to shake.
"That'll give you away," said Laith, refusing the proffered hand. "Few here would offer to shake bare hands with a stranger."
The man lowered his hand and offered a slight smile instead, showing an even row of white teeth.
"I am Father Silvio." "Another bad habit," said Laith. "Don't introduce yourself to people you don't know. How do you know who I am?"
"You are Laith," said Father Silvio. "Archie in the boat told me so."
Laith inspected Silvio carefully. The priest was shorter than Laith, and from his face presumably slim, though he looked well-rounded in several layers of warm clothing. Laith guessed that he was in his mid-40s, with dark eyes and weathered skin. The priest wore, as all of them did, a thin cloak of reflective silvery polymer meant to frustrate infrared drone cameras.
"You're clean-shaven. That's another problem for your cover story," said Laith. "Come on, let's get you dressed."
They headed into an abandoned warehouse as the canoe pushed off behind them.
"We don't have much time before curfew. Do as I say and move quickly."
"I will do my best to follow your instructions," said Father Silvio.
His speech had the precision of a well-educated person who had learned English as a second language, with just a hint of a Spanish accent. Inside the warehouse, Laith led Silvio through a dark and cavernous space. The floors were littered with the splinters of shipping pallets, the pallets themselves having long ago been broken up and burned as fuel. They entered a small room where Laith had stowed several bags and a battery-operated lamp. He clicked on the lamp and took a closer look at Silvio's clothing. It was dark and dignified, though without an obvious priest's collar. That was something, at least. The man wore a thick black coat.
"Is this wool?"
asked Laith, pinching the material.
"Alpaca," Silvio replied. "It was a gift from my parish on my departure for the cold northern climates."
Laith inspected the coat briskly and pulled a small black rectangle from one pocket.
"A phone? Are you joking?"
"It's off," protested Silvio. "I thought..."
"What you thought doesn't matter," said Laith. "They consider any phone without their spyware installed to be a foreign cyber warfare device. The YEA can track any wireless signal that reaches over a kilometer. They shut down internet access and open cell networks years ago. You use this, they'll find you in minutes and make you wish you were in a triage camp."
"I see," said Silvio.
"Don't use their phones either. You won't be allowed one in the camp, and even if you could find one, it would be tapped. They have a supercomputer that scans every communication for subversive content. As for the coat, it's no good," added Laith, to Silvio's obvious surprise and disappointment. "It doesn't match your cover story. Too new, too clean, too nice. Same for your shoes, your hat. I need you to take those off. Actually, take everything off."
Silvio sighed, but then obediently stripped in the frigid air. In a few moments, he was in his underwear, standing on a pile of his own clothes so as not to step on the freezing, grimy floor. Laith sighed.
"Even your underwear looks brand new."
"I have had these for many years," said Silvio, crossing his arms over his chest and shivering slightly.
But Laith shook his head.
"Elastic band is still stretchy. Dead giveaway."
Laith found an appropriately aged and threadbare set of socks and underclothes in one of his bags. The priest changed reluctantly as Laith looked away. Laith assembled a new outfit for the priest, mixing clothing he had brought with the priest's own articles. He allowed the priest to keep his own dark sweater, but rubbed it on the floor until it was thoroughly soiled. A pair of well-worn sneakers, a hole in the left toe, replaced the priest's shiny leather shoes. A dingy hoodie and jean jacket combo substituted for the alpaca coat. Even Silvio's dark hat was exchanged for a woven acrylic toque that was slowly but obviously unraveling.
"Perfect," said Laith as he took in the new ensemble. "You'll fit right in. Now let's go. It's 45 minutes to curfew, and we're in the wrong part of the city."
Evelyn was still dazed from the afternoon's events when she reached her apartment complex that evening. A smoggy orange sunset silhouetted the high-rise towers and the clusters of antennae atop them. On the nearest roof, she saw a YEA sniper looking over the edge, smoking a cigarette. Authority guards clustered around the door to her building, ready for shift change. Their uniforms were not new, but had been neatly patched. These men were responsible for guarding and maintaining the nest of telecom gear, jamming, transmission, and listening antennae atop Evelyn's building. Unlike low-level armbands, they wore thick overcoats with embroidered armor security logos. Evelyn slipped past them without making eye contact and entered her building. Once inside, Evelyn heard YEA radio playing in the lobby.
A rebel town surrendered to authority forces this afternoon after a prolonged battle that began when terrorists attacked a charcoal convoy. The battle left 12 people dead, but the surrender is expected to relieve high charcoal prices. And two apartment buildings were quarantined today after yet another outbreak of antibiotic-resistant staphylococcus. Officer of Public Health Todd Buchanan blames the outbreak on rampant use of black market antibiotics by residents of the building.
People have to understand that there are consequences for using dangerous contraband drugs, he explained. It's everyone's duty to report illness or signs of drug trafficking.
The quarantine is expected to last for several months.
The lobby was tidy and well-kept, if dim in the light of flickering fluorescence. Old layers of paint, once a cheerful spring green, flaked from the walls, but any loose bits had been swept up and disposed of. The yellowing tiles of the floor were chipped, and several were missing, but the floor itself had been recently mopped. A bulletin board with community notices, neatly arranged messages and requests for blankets and batteries, hung on the wall between the elevator doors and the stairwell. Evelyn could see a note addressed to her from her downstairs neighbor, Mrs. Schmidt, who often enlisted Evelyn's help in filling out healthcare fee waiver request forms. Evelyn tucked the note into her pocket. The only graffiti in the lobby was on the large, yellowing Third Pandemic Act poster. Someone had scratched at the heading Pandemic until only the letters P-A-N and I-C remained. Where large print warned that gatherings of more than 8 people were forbidden, someone had added, unless they are asshole cops. The graffiti's creativity diminished from there. Evelyn walked past the elevators and into the stairwell. She lived on the 12th floor, but elevators were strictly for YEA guards. When she was 6 floors up, she heard the rumble of the elevator as a night shift ascended to their rooftop post. As she passed the 8th floor, she heard someone strumming away on a guitar with a broken string. When she stepped out onto her own floor, she sighed heavily and began to relax for the first time in hours. She unlocked her apartment and stepped in. Compact fluorescent bulbs flickered overhead, their fixtures damaged by prolonged brownouts. Hello? She called. She heard tiny footfalls, and a little boy came careening around a corner, flinging himself into her arms.
Evelyn! He yelled excitedly.
She lifted him up and spun him around a few times, smiling widely.
How was your day, Sid? She asked.
We harvested carrots, he said, grinning back.
He had missing baby teeth where his adult teeth were coming in. A woman followed him into view.
We didn't harvest them, Sid, she said. We just took them out of the cold cellar. Hello, Rumi.
She kissed Evelyn warmly on the lips, and they embraced, all three of them holding close. I hate it when you call me that, said Evelyn, smiling into Sarah's hair. As they hugged, Sarah felt the tears in the back of Evelyn's coat. She pulled away, her face concerned.
What happened to your jacket?
Evelyn lost her smile. Incident at a surprise checkpoint today. They were searching everyone and some guy freaked out and... She glanced at Sid and then spelled the word S-H-O-T, some guards. Sarah's eyes widened.
Oh my God, are you okay?
I'm fine, said Evelyn, shaken up. It was a heck of a day, I just need a glass of water.
The water is rustier than usual, said Sarah. Take your shoes off and sit down, and Sid will get me that cider from the fridge.
Sid opened the sliding door onto the balcony, which required his full strength. On the chilly cement of the balcony were several bags of carrots, a few jars of kimchi and pickled vegetables, and a plastic jug of apple cider. Sid picked up the jug of cider, slid the door shut, and handed the bottle to Sarah. Sarah sniffed it, shrugged, and poured some of it into a saucepan to heat on the electric stove. Evelyn sat on the couch, Sid by her side, and recounted what had happened at the checkpoint, mouthing certain words so that Sid couldn't hear. Sarah sat down next to Evelyn and caressed her arm gently. I'm so sorry you saw that, baby. I'm glad you're all right. That's not even the weirdest thing that happened, said Evelyn. I got stuck in the checkpoint because I was being transferred to triage administration. Sarah's hand froze and her body stiffened.
What?
Yeah, said Evelyn, complete surprise. I didn't get the promotion, not enough funding, so they sent me over to triage. And I have to say, those people are really nice. Made me feel at home. Nice warm building, well lit.
Evelyn, don't you know what they do? Asked Sarah, her brow furrowed in concern and disbelief.
Evelyn frowned. They keep disease from spreading. They give people medicine. They take care of sick people.
They also quarantine people who don't want to cooperate with the authority, replied Sarah. Who do you think pays collection bounties to the security franchises?
Sure, the triage system is flawed, Evelyn shrugged. But if the people who work there are more compassionate, the system will be more compassionate. We can't fix problems by just complaining about them. We've got to fix them from the inside. Where do you want me to work?
Sarah was shaking her head. You don't understand. The rumors about what they do in that building, they change people.
They aren't going to change me, Sarah.
That's not what I mean, said Sarah. They change people's minds. They alter their...
She trailed off as she glanced at Sid.
These people, the system they run, it's monstrous.
Sarah, they aren't monsters, said Evelyn. The cafeteria serves albacore and chocolate pudding. The water is clear and the pressure is great. And they dress classy, almost retro, like it's the 40s.
Obviously, said Sarah.
No, the 1940s, Evelyn said. Rumors aside, we need more money to take care of Sid. He needs better rations. He needs fresh fruit. He needs...
There was a loud knock on the door. Public safety.
Sarah and Evelyn stared at each other in surprise. Sid started to say something, but Sarah cut him off.
Go play in your room, she said firmly.
Evelyn went to the door and looked through the eye hole. An armor security guard with blue gloves and a white face mask was standing at their door, along with the building superintendent. Evelyn opened the door halfway, but stood squarely in the gap. She was not offering an invitation. The guard spoke first.
Ma'am, our chemical tests show traces of illegal drugs in this building. Do you know anything about that?
Evelyn left her face a neutral mask. I haven't heard anything about that.
We have positive tests on sewage from this building. One or more people are using illegal drugs. We don't overlook that sort of thing, ma'am.
The superintendent interrupted in a slurring British accent.
I won't have people using illicit drugs here. This is a clean building. No drugs.
He seemed slightly drunk and unaware of the irony.
Ask her roommate.
Sarah appeared at Evelyn's shoulder.
Is there a problem?
Ma'am, the superintendent tells us you give people medications, herbal medications. Is that true?
Sarah was nonchalant.
Mint tea for a cough, aloe for a burnt hand, nothing pharmaceutical. Can I ask what drugs you found?
Metabolites of tetracycline, ciprofloxacin, strictly regulated antibiotics, said the guard. Under the Third Pandemic Act, I have a right to search suspicious residences. Would I find anything untoward if I were to do a search?
Nothing but a messy kitchen, Sarah replied.
Well, I might just have a look all the same, said the guard.
But the superintendent shook his head and pointed to his watch.
It's almost evening power down. I pay a fortune on these winter nights if things run late.
The guard shrugged.
If you see anything suspicious, you be sure to let us know.
The two women nodded. The guard and the superintendent left. Evelyn shut the door. They returned to the couch and took each other's hands. Sarah was frowning, shaking her head.
That superintendent needs to shut the fuck up. Bringing guards here? What an asshole.
It's just a random check, said Evelyn. They can't monitor every building's plumbing for antibiotics all the time.
Maybe, said Sarah dubiously.
You'll have to tell Mrs. Schmidt to use the composting toilet, Evelyn said, until her lung infection clears up.
I did tell her, said Sarah, but she has trouble walking outside in winter.
Maybe we can set up a sawdust bucket toilet in her apartment.
Sid emerged from his room.
Evelyn, will you read to me?
Evelyn nodded. Get your pajamas on and pick a book. We only have a few minutes before lights out.
Why must we walk so far? Father Silvio asked Leith as they trudged along a dim waterfront path.
The city is divided into zones with different security levels and contractors doing enforcement, said Leith. We need to get you to the right zone without hitting any checkpoints along the way.
This zone has many Spanish-speaking Catholics.
This company's specialty is a Spanish-speaking workforce, replied Leith.
And the companies control movement and economics in each zone.
Leith nodded, adjusting the hood of his anti-IR cloak to better conceal his face from the sky.
It's like a franchise.
It sounds more like a fiefdom, answered Silvio.
I guess that's for you to decide, said Leith. Is this very different from where you come from?
Oh yes, Silvio replied, very different.
This, Leith decided, was the moment to probe for truthfulness, or perhaps for some mental illness behind Silvio's reckless plan.
Tell me about where you're from, Leith suggested. It is very beautiful and warm, Silvio replied. Never cold like this. Food grows through the entire year.
Sounds like everyone is well fed.
Oh, there has been hunger everywhere, but we have done no worse than anyone these past years.
A vague non-answer. Leith wanted to elicit a more concrete response.
So I would guess that you're from Ecuador or Puerto Rico, maybe?
Silvio chuckled apologetically.
I have been told not to be too specific about my life and home, for safety. My trainers, they call it security culture.
No doubt, said Leith. Your trainers were from the church?
Silvio was silent.
Did your ship depart from Havana?
Silvio made a very ambiguous sounding, noise.
What kind of ship was it?
A sailing ship, answered Silvio. A very beautiful one.
Leith knew for a fact that Silvio had not arrived on a sailing ship.
Oh, how many masts?
My life in the church has not given me the nautical experience to understand ship design, Silvio replied.
Bullshit, Leith thought to himself, but he changed topic.
Don't broadcast that you're from so far south, Leith advised. The fear of tropical disease here is extreme. If anyone asks, claim to have arrived a long time ago. And for God's sake, don't tell anyone you're a Catholic priest. There are evangelical gangs in the camps.
Under duress, I will claim to be an agricultural worker, brought in before the borders closed, Silvio said with certainty.
Leith wanted to ask more, but clearly Silvio had been instructed to stay tight-lipped. Besides, they had almost reached their target zone. They turned away from the water and paused in a shadowed doorway. Leith faced the priest.
Silvio, you don't have to take this risk. You can't understand what happens in this zone. Urban mining, hazardous waste reclamation. There are safer ways to get information.
It's not just information, Leith, Silvio said. There are people suffering here, and it is my duty to minister to them.
Leith just nodded.
You'll go through this door and turn left, he said. There's a permanent checkpoint 100 meters down the road. Just before the checkpoint, there's a red brick alley on the right. Go into the alley and wait.
Silvio took a deep breath and nodded.
Thank you, Leith.
Leith checked his watch.
Almost curfew. Go now.
Silvio walked through the door and turned left. Leith counted to 20 in his head and followed. Addie stayed in the map room for some time after Carlos had gone out to do his evening chores.
She was still staring at maps well after sunset when the electric lights abruptly went out. Addie cursed and looked out the window. The whole farmstead was dark. The problem must be at the generator. She walked downstairs through the kitchen where a dozen people had been holding a meal planning meeting before the lights had gone. I'll check it, she said.
Addie put on her coat and boots, grabbed a wind-up flashlight, and left the farmhouse.
The air was chilly, but the full moon offered some light, illuminating the old mural of a flowering pink thistle on the barn. She walked to the stream and followed it downhill. The heart of the farm was a shallow valley bisected by this creek. On the east side of the creek were farmhouses, a greenhouse, the common hall topped with solar panels, cabins, barns, a root cellar, the militia's small armory, gardens, cropland, forest, and the only access road. On the west side were forest, pasture, hayfield, and the quarry precipice. Addie reached the bottom of the little valley, where the creek trickled into a small pond. The water level was visibly low. Precipitation had been short all year. A few ducks sat near the edge, but the pond itself was thinly frozen over, a round black mirror. She paused for a moment to gaze into it, but could not see the bottom. A buried pipe 4 inches in diameter ran from that pond, down the steep cliff where farm gave way to the void of the quarry, and through a micro-hydro generator shed at the bottom of the cliff. Addie stared down toward the shed, its roof gleaming faintly in the moonlight, and then carefully began to descend the stairs and ladders that would bring her, ledge by icy ledge, to the bottom. The generating station was a small shack on a ledge about 10 feet above the water level of the quarry. Addie entered the chilly structure. Batteries were stacked on shelves against each wall. Most were very old and had been repaired many times, their failed or damaged cells neatly bypassed with copper wire. There were golf cart batteries, RV batteries, even a few deep cycle batteries being used for their intended purpose. The ramshackle system was undamaged, but a voltage gauge showed the battery bank was almost completely drained. Their large inverter had shut itself off. The thistle didn't have an electrical surplus in the winter. Short days meant people were inside in the evenings, using lights, stereos, sewing machines, and soldering guns. Their patchwork battery bank just didn't have the storage capacity for the number of people who now lived at the thistle. Most of their winter power.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.